for October 17th, 2016. And first up is a minor site plan review from Mutual Oil. Julie, do you wanna summarize what we're doing?
Yeah, sure. So, the gist of this project is Mutual Oil is looking to replace six, pump islands and six pumps. The pump replacement is something that the DEP has been requiring. I think they only have a few months left to comply with the DEP requirement. Basically, it will include the installation of a sump, and a sensor, so if there's an oil leak, the pump will be alerted, and, you know, then the people who work there will be alerted, and the leak will not continue for too long. So that's really the crux of what they're looking to do tonight. The signage package is just for your information. It came in around the same time as this application, but you don't really have jurisdiction over signs in business A. So. Good?
Brett?
If I may?
Sure.
Thank you. You summed it up well. There really are three parts to it. As you indicated, with the DEP standard, we have to have a sump for that kind of storage. In addition, they're looking to put in pumps that have a smart code, so if you avoid fraud and use of credit cards, that's an upgrade to the dispenser. And the islands themselves, the cracking and the curving is breaking on them. You guys sent you some pictures with the filing, but here's some more that I took. Just I thought maybe show a little better the condition of how this is deteriorating. And there's also a crack in the island, a couple of the islands themselves. So the islands have been replaced exactly with what's there now. There's no change in the configuration of the islands. So that's the mistake. I have one more picture just for the record. And this is the one that shows the actual crack in the island, where the edging curving is separating from the rest of the concrete. I guess that's a normal stress result. But basically, the objective is to replace that as well. So the result, from a site plan perspective, is the same thing. You end up with the same island, you end up with new dispensers, and you end up on the ground with a sump that meets DEP requirements. And that's pretty much it as far as the minor modification. We gave notice to over 300 abutters, because it included Pulte's new project, unfortunately, and the notice being given. So it was well aware of what they've asked for. The second part, as Julie mentioned, is an informative issue, and that is on the signage. This property has a variance from the Board of Appeals, what is being proposed is signage that's consistent with the standards allowed by the ZBA in their decision. If you have any questions in that regard, we provided some drawings of that. I'm more than happy to answer any questions that you may have in that context as well. Thank you very much.
You're going to go with a stainless rim around the island this time?
Pardon?
Stainless steel rim around the island this time?
Yes.
For the curb?
Let's see if you're lying to me, okay? The contractor and the consultant at the gas station, so
okay.
Yeah, we're very informed.
I guess we don't have any jurisdiction on signs, but what is this? Is this opaque with just a triangle and the Citgo lighting up?
The signs that they submitted to me, I believe, meet the requirements outlined in the variance decision, as well as most of them also meet the bylaw.
Yeah, okay. It just doesn't say that the white is opaque, and I'm pretty sure the cover sign is.
Once we actually get close to the permit, I'll get a sample.
Okay. And no additional lighting on the valance on those pumps?
No, there's no lighting any different than what's there right now.
Okay. Well, if it was going to take care of that, I think on this one.
I know that we have provisions in there for the pricing things. I was a little surprised to see the cash and regular for both the regular and the diesel.
Yeah,
We have a provision where?
Well, we have, well, there's some provision in the bylaw about the price signage for the gas stations. But I wasn't, you know, the more typical configuration on the pylon sign, or whatever you want to call it, the upright sign, is the regular premium and diesel, but not the cash versus credit distinction.
I know the mobile on Main and Summer has at least three.
Well, three is the regular.
I know, so if it's four and it's not blinking, I'm not opposed to that.
Okay.
I don't like that the LEDs on the pumps are blinking. You know, that's kind of annoying, but as long as the big sign is not blinking, I don't know that four is going to make a difference.
Okay, I mean, there's something that I noticed.
Yeah, did we actually say that, though, that they can't have four? Did we say that?
I don't think we specified.
No.
I don't think so. John or Karen, anything?
Okay, so which of these things do we need to vote on, if anything?
We only need to vote on the decision, since signage is not in here, we don't have to stamp anything.
Okay. Move that the CPDC approve the minor site plan review decision for the work proposed at 8385 Main Street, Mutual Oil.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? Doing signage for these. Can that be done administratively? Did anyone see anything on here that we needed to hold them up for? No changes in lighting, no changes in configuration, so no changes in the number of pumps, no changes to the traffic patterns, you know, driveway curb cuts.
Yeah.
And if signage is not included in it.
Well.
I wonder if that's just something we could get done administratively.
Yeah, so that was initially what we were thinking, but then it was like, well, it's a gas station, it's on Main Street, it's visible. Every gas station in town is residential abutters.
Yeah.
And then it turned out that we didn't realize it was going to catch the edge of that Redding Woods property.
Oh.
Which it did. And so Thursday, at the end of the day, like a couple of weeks ago, we were all like frantically stuffing envelopes. I had no idea that was the monster I created.
It's a 300-foot, yeah, okay.
So.
Yeah, I think it's really those gas stations, you know, it's six of one, half dozen of the other. Something seems so minor that maybe it could be, but it was above the threshold.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that's the way we were looking at it, being over 500 square feet.
Above the threshold, but it's also replacement in kind, so.
Right.
The sign is different, and
sign
the sign's
is
not included
yeah.
right now, so that's.
It's a little vague the way the bylaw is now on replacement in kind, so.
I think that we purposefully left it that way, so that when you all saw something that may trigger something that's more. There may be of some more public interest that we do have a public process, because I mean that gas station is front and center enough that people may have had some issues
with it.
Yeah.
That's really
likely not the detailed substance of that, But it's enough of a change that people may be like, you know, what's going on, why this, why that.
I am 100% in favor of encouraging notification. So, you know, administrative procedures or whatever, I mean, it's, we want to know what's going on.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay, so next is signed permit applications, Cooling Unlimited in Maine, 565.
They came this morning to our office at 8:30, and I told them 11 more hours.
Well, they're
and they said they were gonna try to make it, so.
Oh, okay, it's early.
It's
yeah,
a little early,
it's
8
o'clock,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, let's do this, these minutes then, unless you want to do something else first.
Okay.
I looked at these online and I didn't have any.
I had no corrections or comments here. Karen, anything about the minutes?
No.
Did we take them out of order or get them out of the way?
Guessing game. Most of what we do is guessing game.
It is a guessing game.
Yeah, there's plenty to talk about.
Yeah.
Okay, John?
Yeah.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of September 26th, 2016, as presented.
Second. All in favor?
Draft presentations for town meeting.
Sure.
Which one?
Presentation sounds more fun to me. But
well, the stormwater bylaws are, that's something that's coming up at town meeting.
Well, the Board of Selectmen had asked for CPDC's opinion on whether or not this was ready to go for November town meeting, because it is so heavily skewed to be the responsibility of CPDC. And staff.
Hmm. Oh, she's here.
Sign permit?
Holly, is anyone else coming with you?
Just me.
Okay. Did you mind if we start a few minutes early?
Yeah, it's fine with me.
Okay.
Anyone else want
to? If you're ready, we're ready.
Yeah. Whatever you like.
That's good. Wherever you want to be.
Okay, so back to signed permit for Cooling Unlimited and Maine 565. And a certificate of appropriateness, I guess, right? Because we're in business B. So it looks like you're taking down the existing canopies, awnings, sorry. And then putting flat signs on either side of a new awning.
Exactly, yep. He's gonna be caulking up the holes himself, the building owner, once he takes the awnings down, painting it the same color it's already painted.
Okay.
So, I don't think that would be an issue.
What kind of condition is that white background in?
A pretty good condition, actually. I went over there myself. I have some photos, I think maybe on my phone. But yeah, no, it's in pretty good condition. There's no rust or anything like that from the aluminum left behind on the, it's like a stucco.
Yes, okay.
Okay. And we've got the one street light right in front, more or less in front of the door, is that right?
Correct, yep.
Okay. Yep.
I believe on Main 565, underneath, there's a fluorescent light bulb there too, I believe. That's more for like the sidewalk. It's already existing.
Underneath, up against the wall?
Like, it would be, you can't really see it in the picture, but it's like right here. So this overhangs a little bit, so it's like right underneath the overhang, shining down onto the sidewalk, though.
Do we need it?
No, but it's already there. It's been there. They're not doing anything with it, as far as I know.
Not exposed bulb, is it?
Exposed?
Exposed fluorescent bulb?
No, I think it has like a plastic casing over it. I don't know if they illuminated or not. I just know that it's there because they were thinking about maybe doing a boost neck down the road and if there was any electricity running over there. But I don't know if they have it illuminated because I've never been over there at night.
This angle is too high.
Guess we could drive by on our way home tonight.
Yeah. That's right around the corner.
Otherwise, they're just unlit signs.
Correct, yeah. Both the businesses, my understanding, run during the daytime anyways. 9 to 5 hours, so.
Okay.
Is that the color sample, the Pacific Blue?
No, this is actually just a sample to give you an idea of the sign foam versus wood carved signs. It's a lot lighter than your regular foam, so that would be like the finish, just to get an idea of that. But I do have the Pacific Blue awning sample.
It's actually not that light. I'd love that.
Looks good.
Oh yeah, but on the signs, the color, yeah, the PMS color, yep. It'd be the same.
So is something happening on the right, on the pier, at the very right edge of the page? There seems to be some overlay happening there. And I'm not sure if
this here?
Yeah.
Mainly we just blocked that, I don't know if there's something there. Mainly we did it mostly for the owner to superimpose, to show him what it's gonna look like.
Okay.
This is just brick behind it.
You're not proposing to put anything there?
No, nothing's going there. Everything will remain the same, just the awnings are going to come off. They're going to touch up the paint. And then those two will be hung with L brackets and stainless steel L brackets and masonry screws into the building. And then the awning would be installed as well the same way.
The awning has sides to it?
Yep.
Another picture.
Yeah, there's a side view.
Yeah.
No, the overlay, I think, on the picture is because there was the other side of the awning.
Yeah, the awning, the existing awnings extend onto the brick.
That's fine.
Exactly. So the 2 inches that you see in there, that's the side view of the signs. Both signs are 2 inches thick. then they get engraved in.
Yep.
So they wouldn't be any thicker than that. And then the awning sticks out 36 inches from the building, 102 inches off the sidewalk in height. And then the red is mainly the bricks from a
mm-hmm.
side view. And the awning gets mounted 24 inches from the roof of the building to where the top of the awning begins is 2 feet.
At 102 inches is from the low side, the center, or the right?
From the center.
From the center.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right in front of the doorway.
Okay.
I believe it stands out the same amount as what's existing now, but I don't quote me on it, but I'm pretty sure it's about 3 feet. Right now they have a scalloped awning, which is like a rounded awning.
Right.
It's very outdated, and the awning they have now is ripped in several places, so for appearance-wise it would look better.
The bottom of the awning is at 144,
yeah.
Which is 12, or something like that. Or the top of the awning, rather.
The top, right, but it's the bottom here that we care about.
Yeah, it's 102.
No, you're saying it's at the center, so I'm just looking to see to make sure that we don't lose 6 inches to the left side here. You slope it up. If you look at the elevation
yes,
picture.
Yes, I know you're saying the sidewalk kind of dips.
Yeah, so the low side has to be 8 feet. So this 102 is measured right down the center.
Correct.
But the left edge of the awning has to be 8 feet.
Okay.
So
that's
when
nice.
You get out there
six
and measure it, if you're off a little bit, you might have to
okay.
raise
it. All right, so we might have to just bring it up. We got 2 feet to play with.
Yeah,
so
you
we
go.
Can do that. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So would you say it was 8 feet it has to be?
Yeah.
In
8 feet
of
clearance.
The smallest clearance.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. Let the installer know that when they mount it.
It actually looks
make sure
like
they do that.
It looks like it slopes in the front of the building, but that it's
right
it's
there. It's
pretty,
level.
Yeah. It's
right.
pretty close to
right
to
there. It's
level
flat.
There.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not absolutely, but it looks like it's
slope flat.
Yeah, I mean, I think
slope.
They'll get this.
Yeah.
And just want to point
yeah.
that out. That's all.
Do you
want
to add something about that just to make sure?
I marked this page up.
Okay.
We're gonna stamp this,
yep.
right?
Yep.
But we always we already say in our decision that it has to be 8 feet.
It's
not a condition, it's a finding. I can add a condition. We actually have two
certificates
of appropriateness.
Yeah, separate
okay.
business arms.
Yeah, Cooling Unlimited, he owns the business, he also owns the building. And he's the one that's going to be paying for the sign and the awning.
Okay.
And then she's paying for her own sign, Michelle, for Main 65.
You know what? I should switch these then. No, wait. I did it right. Okay.
Yeah, we put the
I'm confusing
on
myself with this.
I looked over like a million times.
Okay. All right. So, yeah, I put them on. Yeah, that's right.
Okay. The decision says that the 565 will be 8 inches in height. Is that correct? You mentioned
yep.
nine?
Oh, if it says eight, I apologize. It's eight.
Okay.
And
CPDC approve the certificate of appropriateness for the sign permit at 565 Main Street for Main 565.
Second.
All in favor?
Move that the CPDC approve the certificate of appropriateness for the sign permit at 565 Main Street for Cooling Unlimited. And is this the one that including the awning sign?
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
We're good.
Do we stamp the actual certificate or just the picture?
Just the drawings.
I know when the next meeting is going to be. We actually have another one in the works, like 2 shows over.
November 7th. So I'll finalize and send it to you.
Thank you. So I come in tomorrow? Do I need to get the permit?
I'll send it to you tomorrow and then you can, I have some meetings in the morning, so you got one. Just wait until I send it to you first.
No rush, I'm not getting installed like tomorrow, so.
Okay.
Thank you.
Moving right along.
Yeah, I'm gonna have all our meetings be 66 minutes.
Then you share it with town.
Whether the business gets done or not.
How many minutes?
66.
Could probably stretch it to 75 if we needed to.
All right.
Okay, so we were talking about the,
Do you want to talk about stormwater bylaw?
Yeah.
Should I pull it up?
So I reviewed that and there's really, to me, I think there, if it does get approved, I see some things that we'll need to do through that provision of making administrative rules, but nothing in there that seemed like we couldn't do that. And it's coordination between our process and that process and wins and wheres and plan. It's all stuff that we can work through. The one thing that I did see that was a little bit odd or awkward and do you have a copy? This very first, regulated activities where it mentions that, well, no person shall perform any activity that results in disturbance of one or more acres or as part of a larger common plan or sale.
What section is it, John?
7941.
Okay.
So I guess my question is, well, first of all, that sentence is worded very awkwardly, and I don't know how this comes into play where the whole notion of regulating a sale of property, or is that regulating a sale or regulating something that someone may sell in the future? It's an odd thing to have part of a land use regulation is, you know, is the sale part. And it may be okay. It's just written so awkwardly that I can't quite figure out whether it would cause problems or not.
Is the 1 or more acres, to clarify, like between our process and the NFT's process? Like, which would be overseen by the town engineer? Because I know that's the threshold for requiring like a SWIP and NFT's permit. I'm just not sure.
Just that the language in that sentence transitions after disturbance of 1 or more acres of land. And from or is part of, it just, that makes no sense to
me. Like I was trying to dissect it and I think it's saying that you can't disturb a parcel that may be part of a larger common plan of development, which I get, that makes sense.
That has its own process.
The part that, but if you take all of that out, you can't disturb a parcel that may be part of a sale.
Yeah, well.
That will ultimately disturb 1 or more acres. So are we gonna try and regulate before the sale happens? That's the thing that I think that.
Well, I
or
think
are we regulating something, something that's a parcel that may be part of a larger, I don't know. It's just, it's so awkward.
I know what the language is trying to say, which is you can't cut it up to avoid this. I mean, that's the intent of the thing, is that you can't
say.
I agree.
If you have 3 parcels that are all part of 1 development, maybe you need to like combine them, consolidate them first,
well,
or at least
if the combination would result in disturbing more than an acre, it doesn't matter that any individual one is below the threshold. It still applies.
But that's what a common plan of development is.
Right,
so
exactly.
That's
right.
Good.
Yeah.
I'm fine with that. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Why is there
the word sale
in there?
Especially with the that will ultimately disturb. We don't know.
We don't know.
What they're gonna
do
with that land.
We don't have a crystal
ball. And so that's the one thing. That's the one piece. Like I don't know whether that to me. I think that town councils should look and see whether that's something that's
he wrote this.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
He should tell us what he's trying to say.
Yeah.
Because
it doesn't say that.
If you insert the word or the phrase condition of sale, maybe that clarifies it.
Well,
it's either a common plan of development or a condition of sale. It's a, you know, off the cuff kind of.
So there's 2 ways this can go. If CPDC wants to act tonight in one way or the other, to either say it needs more work, it needs more time, or it's ready with recommended changes and we go back to town council, the warrant is going to print probably
really
next
soon.
Week, yeah. So the time is of the essence to, and the board won't have another meeting.
No, but so if we get clarification on this and we don't get it in time to affect the printing, we can change that in a town meeting, or is this going to be outside the moderator's four corners?
I would say that
they don't like.
Yeah, we want to try and avoid that if we can. This it isn't going to hold anything up. We're not going to be delayed from meeting the regulation if it goes to annual town meeting.
Okay.
So there's so much on subsequent town meeting right now with 8 zoning articles that I would hate to see this causing a lot of disturbance at town meeting. Just because there's so much to be done, so much to go through.
The rules that are mentioned
like
in 7931, the rules that are mentioned in 7931 that we have to adopt, are those, is that zoning? Is that had to go through the full process?
No, this is in the general bylaw.
This is just general, these are rules.
Yeah.
And you guys can adopt rules and regulations with just a public hearing, I think.
Yep. Yep.
Actually, I'm, now that we're talking.
Figure out what that meant for us.
Yeah.
About that paragraph you mentioned, John. It also is confusing because it's regulated activities, but it just basically says what you can't do. So, does that mean that everything else is regulated?
Except those outdoors.
Or does that mean that you can't do it without a permit, and so that's what's regulated? I'm not clear.
Right, yes.
Okay.
Because really, the only thing it says in there is you can't disturb land. If it meets these, if it meets these certain conditions. Right, I mean, if you cut to the chase.
So, I mean, I'm wondering, is this attempting to capture those single family lots that are less than an acre that normally wouldn't come before you guys or get a NPDES permit?
No, I read it the other way around. These are all have to be greater than an acre, right?
Well, we already have the state, and actually the federal government has a process for sites that disturb more than an acre. So is this supposed to be in conjunction with that?
That's what Jean had said the other day.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is...
Okay.
Brings us into conformance with the...
And it gives us some control if we want to do something over and above the state process.
Okay.
So it's meant to overlap it.
Okay. And is that, do you know, Jean, like, did town council say, are most towns that are doing stormwater bylaws putting it in the hands of the planning board?
I assume so, because that's the way he's drafted it. I think this comes from some model somewhere.
Mm.
Because really, where else would it?
Look,
would it,
like Public Works Commission, I know we don't have one, but some towns have one.
Yeah.
Or like even just the town engineer or the Conservation Commission or people that deal with stormwater systems more frequently than.
Well, the way that it says, we could turn the administration over of this entirely to town engineer. I mean, it gives us that latitude to do that.
That's true. I guess I'm just wondering, like, what the impetus for putting this with us is. Like, if it's true that we could turn it over, like, why do we even start here?
I think
we're the one board
else.
In town that has anything to do with land development.
Yeah.
Right.
I think whatever rules we come up with should have that administrative option, though. If we can figure out what the limits are for something small enough, simple enough, where the engineer could just look at it and get it moving, rather than bring people here at night, that would be helpful.
Well, and do you guys feel comfortable with your expertise in, like, reviewing stormwater treatment trains and all the other technical stuff that comes with that? I'm just...
No, I mean, the way that I see this is we get a lot of this at site plan review for most projects. I mean, a lot of these projects will be going through site plan review. It will be, what we'll have to do is marry our site plan review with this, and so it will be just another approval.
Right.
Yeah.
Because it's stuff that George in engineering reviews anyways.
Yep.
So I don't see in 95% of the cases that this will make one bit of difference. It's when someone is doing something a little bit out of sequence, or they want to clear the site and then do something else, and they're not quite ready, and, you know, PUDs, it might change the way that you phase things.
Or, like, if you had a project that wouldn't normally come to you guys, but triggers this.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Okay, so then you wouldn't necessarily be marrying two processes, so it would be a standalone process.
Right.
Okay.
And that's the thing, I think, if this gets approved, that we need to sit down and lay out what the process is. But I think we can do that within this.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think that's reason enough to say don't move forward.
Mm-hmm.
I just saw that one, what it is, the most important part, what the regulated, who does it apply to? That's the thing, it's not clear.
Right. Mm. Okay.
Yeah, recommend a reevaluation of that or whatever you want.
Yeah, I do think that this is, that there is likely to be enough, or this is one of those things that people will be concerned about, that will generate a fair amount of.
It'll get bogged down.
Yeah, a fair amount of discussion.
I think so, because I read it and I wasn't exactly sure, even with my background in planning, why. I had a lot of questions when I read it, so.
I just don't think there's gonna be enough time between when we have to get this finalized on the warrant and the, you know, some edits and changes that it sounds like the board is interested in.
Nothing else has to be done to this other than clarifying that. So if we were to push it to your annual town meeting, it's ready to go as soon as we just go around the warrant.
And basically, it's the mention of it's the or sale, you know, and we could either clarify or remove those words. I mean.
Well, I wanna understand what it is he's trying to do there.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But we can't deliberate electronically is what my concern is.
Right.
So it's either, if you feel comfortable having staff work with town council to try and make that a little clearer, we can certainly do that. Because there's not gonna be enough time left to hash it out here.
Would it make sense to, if we did put it on annual town meeting, to also try to prepare some drafting and regulations? To go along with it, like, not, they wouldn't go to town meeting, but kind of to have it all queued up so it's, so there's no lag between once, when it gets approved by town meeting and when applications start coming in.
Well, I think it still has to be approved at the state.
Mm-hmm.
What?
The
general bylaw.
We'd have 3 or 4 months to come up
with
that rule.
So there's a lag anyway.
Yeah, I think
okay.
It's built in. I mean, if that's one way to go at it and just have Julie and I hammer it out with town council, see if we can get that tweaked.
I don't have a problem with that. I would like to just know what it is that they're getting. I'm not sure if anyone for the public parses that differently.
Sorry, I was looking at
Do you have any opinion on what that might mean?
The or sale portion?
Yeah.
The only thing I can think of is that, Tony DeRezzo, 130 John Street. The only thing I can think of is it's kind of a, to prevent somebody from coming up and saying, oh, well, we bought it not knowing what was going on. So therefore, it says if you're going to sell it, you have to understand that you've got your requirements. But I thought that applied to anything. If you go and you buy a piece of property and it doesn't meet zoning or you can't build on it, that's your problem, not the town's.
How do you end?
We've already had a few people that find that out.
Mm-hmm.
So if we hammer this out, we agree to hammer out the town council for the warrant, we agree to put it on the annual.
I think that's what the board.
That's what we need to know.
If
yeah.
if you're comfortable with, you know, us trying to tweak it with town council in time for the warrant to go to print so that there's something more in the language, or if one person from the board wants to work with us, that's another way to go.
Trying to get listeners to have to say. I think that if it's in line with what we've sort of discussed, if that's what we're thinking that they're attending, I don't think it's going to be an issue. If it's something completely different than what we've discussed, then.
Well, if John, if you guys are comfortable to have John work with Julie and I, see if we can tweak it and get it ready. If we can't.
Yeah. If it needs tweaking, I mean, it's.
At least to the satisfaction
right.
of, you know, the three of
so
us.
So there's a reasonable explanation.
Yeah.
And,
right.
Yeah.
You know, it may be notes for the presentation to town meeting,
yeah.
because it is just a general bylaw.
Yeah.
I mean, it's.
I just don't want us to get ourselves in a. Have some bylaw that doesn't make sense or that gets someone in some position not to be able to do something that we didn't think that it stops someone from selling a piece of land for no reason.
Right.
Except that
right.
it's in here. So
yep.
in someone's
levels and the details.
Okay.
You had something, Tony?
Mr. Chairman, Tony DeRosa, 130 John Street. If I might recommend that you try and push this off for the April, the annual town meeting, I have a feeling that the November subsequent town meeting will be very contentious, as I believe there's a special town meeting in the middle of town meeting.
Yes. I mean, the thing is that the as a general bylaw, I mean, I'm not sure what our approval position is. You know, there's nothing wrong with it as.
Meaning it's not ours to drive?
Right.
Yeah.
yeah.
Let's see if we can get some clarity on that.
Yeah. And if it's too muddled, then we'll
go for the annual.
And suggest that that doesn't move forward.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah. And or town meeting will take care of it for us.
Yes. At the cost of an hour or so.
Well, we could probably quickly put it to bed if we feel it's just not going to work. We'll stand up and move the question and shut down. I think if the board stands up and says, fine, it's not ready. Yeah, we understand there's something wrong with it now. I don't know. I think that half the time town meeting doesn't understand some of this complex language, so they rely on the boards that are promoting it.
Mm-hmm. Should we move on?
Yeah. Can we get a? Can we do the subdivision plan?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So next up, review of conceptual subdivision plan 116 Van Norden Road.
Thank you. My name is Jack Sullivan, owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group, as you know. And I basically wanted to get together with you for an informal meeting. I met with Gene and Julie and the town engineer. I have a client looking to potentially develop the end of Harold Avenue. There's this piece of land here. I think it's almost 3 or 4 acres of land. A lot of it's wetland, but there is enough upland to support two lots. We originally thought of doing a PRD style development, and just with the whole way that process is set up, with going through town meeting and then coming back for preliminary hearings and definitive, it ends up being like an 18-month process. It can really get bogged down. So trying to think outside the box, we've looked at maybe doing a conventional subdivision. And with this development, we only have 78 feet of frontage along Harold Avenue. You know, we're required to have a 60-foot right-of-way, and you need to have 30-foot roundings at the entrance. So in total, you would need 120 feet of frontage to put in a conventional roadway without any sort of waiver. So I have showed a rounding here on Harold Avenue with the 60-foot right-of-way with the cul-de-sac in two conforming lots. There's enough frontage, there's enough upland area, and we also have the lot width for each property. So the idea that's I've used in other towns, and the whole reason for the hearing tonight is in North Andover, a lot of times the towns for these smaller subdivisions, the two or three lot subdivisions, they'll allow you to create a right-of-way on paper. You do a design basically with a common driveway to access the two lots, and then you request waivers from the subdivision rules and regulations as far as pavement width, granite curving, street lights, basically most of the subdivision rules and regulations, but you still adhere to drainage and things like that. And then the common driveway would remain private, so the benefit to the town is this would not become an accepted public way. It would remain private. A homeowners association would be formed for maintenance and upkeep of the roadway and also for the drainage systems. So in effect, it would end up like a PRD in that, like with a PRD, you basically end up not building a fully compliant roadway with sidewalks and curbing, but without going through that long process. And I don't, this hasn't really been done in Reading before, so that's why I thought, you know, in order to give my clients some direction, how the board might look at something like this.
Is it in fact two lots to be sold separately?
Not at this time. This is 116 Van Doren Road. So there's a house out here. There was a lot that was carved off out here. And so this piece all back here now is just a parcel of land. It doesn't exist as two lots. It's a single lot that we'd be looking to create two lots, two house lots.
Well, I mean, you showed a drawing with two houses, but you don't show two lots.
Right. This was going to be our PRD style development with a common driveway with two homes. The previous slide, if you go back to the previous slide, Julie. So what would happen with this is these lots, see lot one and lot two, this with the conventional subdivision, if there were waivers of the design standards for the roadway itself, the homes would, one home would sit here, one home would sit here. Those lot lines would exist. So the right-of-way would always exist. It would end up almost like a paper street. That's how the legal frontage would be created for those two lots. But you basically just look for waivers from all other aspects of the subdivision rules and regulations.
Except that the, whatever it is, lot two, is like entirely within the wetland restricted area?
So this is the 35-foot no-build zone. It would be, you know, I may have to look at the lots a little bit. They might be smaller homes. We would have to get approval from conservation as well. We were thinking of trying the PRD, but then when we started talking about this more, and I kind of floated the idea that in other towns, for these smaller type of developments, the towns don't want to maintain the roads and pay for them going forward and snow plowing and everything else associated with them. We thought it might be a good discussion point.
Okay. I don't know offhand how the lot shape last lot circle, minimum lot width, interacts with the wetland restrictions.
It doesn't.
The only thing that
never has
would come into play is that there is a requirement for a certain amount of upland for each developable lot.
And so I believe each lot has to have, it's in the S20 district, so I think you need 12,000 square feet of upland area, which I show.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as the lot shape, that rule of 22, the area times 22 has to be greater than the lot perimeter squared.
No, I mean.
Oh, you're talking about the 80-foot diameter circle.
The lot circle, yeah.
Yeah, that can go anywhere as long as it's tangent to your frontage and fits on your lot.
Yeah, 12,000 square feet of upland for the S20. Right-of-way exists on paper, the legal frontage, then proposed house number two might not be able to be located there. Is that correct?
Both those houses would have to be
shifted.
Right.
Yeah, okay.
That basically that plan we're showing there wouldn't work. that was the PRD concept, and
right.
we just eliminated the right-of-way altogether. If we did a subdivision and look for the waivers, then the houses would have to fit on those lots one and two that we show and conform
okay.
with front, side, and rear setback requirements and all other requirements.
Because you would still sell them off individually?
Correct.
Right.
So it'd be something totally new for this town, at least. In some other towns, like I at least in North Andover and Lexington, have done projects like this. And actually, Stoneham, I did a 5-lot subdivision. They wanted the road to remain private, so they liked the idea too. They didn't want the town dealing with maintaining drainage systems and roadways. And we set up a whole homeowners association for a 5-lot subdivision, keeping everything private. And they didn't waive all the requirements, but they reduced a lot of them.
Kind of precedence that we set, though. If we start waiving all the requirements, we're going to get in trouble.
It could lead to the creation of a provision for a common driveway. If you're worried about setting too much of a precedent, then you could actually make it something that you just allow. That's potentially what you've done in North Andover. Do they have a provision for a common driveway?
They do.
Yeah, and in Concord, this is what they do most of the time with subdivisions that are under a certain size.
Is that vertical line intended to be the property line of this new subdivision?
This line?
Yeah.
Yeah, the idea with this is this area here would be part of the subdivision. This area here, we were looking to either put like a conservation restriction area on or work something out with conservation because there's some interest in, they don't want to own it, but they'd like to have use of it for maybe hiking trails and or some type of passive recreation. And that's something we're going to work with conservation on if this moves forward. Across the street, there was a PRD done back in the mid-90s for two houses right over here. But just going through the PRD process for the site up the street at 149 Van Norden was so lengthy. I think that took like 19 months from the time we started till finally got approved. And contentious at town meeting because people are they don't understand what you're doing with the PRD, even though it's an open space development where you're setting aside at least 40% as open space.
Yeah,
there's a lot of confusion with it.
You might remember that back in 2014 it was Article 7 before the big zoning article, and there was lots of banter and it got pretty ugly.
Mm-hmm. 47,800 square feet for the two houses, so each house sort of meets the minimum S20, right? Or 20? What is it in our town? S20.
Yeah. So is that the total upland area, Jack, or is that just the upland area that's
even
on
more.
The
just,
front
just,
part?
Just this front, the part that
okay.
we're using.
Okay.
I'm trying to understand all of the implications of it. You know, becomes something people use to bypass PRD process, which is there to sort of, supposed to be there to protect the character of those neighborhoods, right? And not just allow sort of super dense developments just because you can squeeze something on.
Well, with the common drive, you can put a cap on the number of lots that it serves. Sort of, you know, it seems like you might want to try to find a way to meet people in the middle on this, because PRD
mm-hmm.
is so onerous. But then common drive isn't really something that's allowed right now. It's just a tough philosophical.
So, yeah, I guess. Sort of all our discussions before have been, you know, the idea here isn't to create different rules so that the town can be more dense or there can be bigger houses or more intense development. It's just that it can be smarter so we don't have like all these cul-de-sacs everywhere for two houses. But, you know, I guess in this case, it's very likely that, you know, something like this would end up developing, allowing bigger houses sort of shoehorned in here in the back than what you, if you did it that way. If you did it by a common drive, then if you did sort of the normal or the this shown on this PRD plan.
You're saying common drive produces bigger houses.
It looks like it could. I mean, you'd have a hard time fitting some of those size houses on that lot too.
Mm-hmm.
And
how do you mean it? I'm sorry. How do you mean it makes for bigger homes?
Because you can't fit in this upland area. I mean, you'd have a really hard time fitting something decent.
Those rectangles,
in there.
If
yeah.
you go back a plan, don't fit with all the setbacks that you need.
Yeah.
Right, but like he said, this right-of-way would exist on paper for legal frontage, so you wouldn't be building the house in that area, am I correct?
Right, but John's point is with the common driveway, yeah, so think of it this way. The homes that I show with the common driveway approach are probably larger than what I can fit on this plan here.
Right.
The trade-off, though, is we're not building out a full road with a paved cul-de-sac, so the amount of impervious, and it's almost like...
Sure, that's one part of
one, part
it,
of
one issue.
Yeah.
That's probably the neighbors, the from a neighborhood perspective, that's the least of issues.
So you could come with a driveway, maybe retain more vegetation on the site. Like Lexington, they're big into these PRDs, but it's almost you don't go to a town meeting to establish an overlay. It's almost like it's a special permit process through this board. But you can go in and make your case, and then you guys, as a special permit, vote. So it's almost, we're probably almost back to discussions on the PRD, ways to streamline that process to make it not such a long process. Still controlled, like a special permit
yeah.
process where you need a majority or supermajority mm-hmm. vote of the board, so there's a lot of control for you guys to govern it. It's just like before I sent my client down that road when I told him it was 18 months, it's just, if there was another way to do it, we wanted to look at and explore maybe some other options just to get dialogue going. I don't even know. I'm not expecting an answer tonight.
But honestly, if we have some other process, it's going to be, for this particular one, it would end up being 18 months to get.
Right, because it would have to go.
To create a new process, get that developed, get it through town meeting, get it through the state, and then start
mm-hmm.
whatever process that is. So,
unless you thought there was some public benefit to granting waivers for the subdivision, before the summer.
Use the waiver process to come up with the rules that we want to establish for the future process.
Yeah.
Is that what you're recommending?
And like in this case, because Harold Avenue is private and not owned by the town wouldn't adopt the right of way if they did build out that whole cul-de-sac bulb anyway. Like it's not going to be a town road.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And our, we have that much leeway in the. We could waive all of the requirements.
I mean, obviously the town engineer has to weigh in on this.
Mm-hmm.
So this is an ongoing conversation, but.
I mean, the actual, the locus, if you look at the bigger map, I mean, there's a whole row of, I don't know what you call them, alleyway lots. I mean, they're narrow and long.
Yeah.
With no access to the bulk of the lots.
They're long, deep lots.
If you brought up the GIS or the map,
okay.
You'd see that.
And we've talked about other types of zoning for that. Done a little bit of a work on that. Because there are a lot of these deep lots.
There's access on both ends, though, right?
No.
Some of them hit both streets?
Some don't, some do.
And that led to some of the conversation with conservation. If we did something with this parcel back here, and then they could approach some of the owners, seeing if they could get a trail system in that would feed out to a connecting street. They need to work with a number of homeowners to do that. If that was they could go piece by piece, they thought it was a start. So we're willing to talk to them on this piece at least. We're just trying to get some direction where to go with how we move forward with this.
I'd like to understand it in the bigger context of all the rest of these lots. I wouldn't want to double the density by allowing something that then we get stuck having to allow every single time.
I guess I wouldn't be opposed to sort of entertaining the discussion of what, you know, if there's a way through waivers to sort of help us figure out what this new process may look like or result in, because that's something we've been struggling with anyhow, and this would give a real world way for us to think through that and think through the repercussions of it. Though that may not lead to in this particular case, I don't know where that would end up leading. I mean, we may get halfway through and say this isn't working.
Yeah, that's a chance that someone trying to develop their property, they take that chance. I think we could probably submit like a preliminary subdivision, list out waivers we're looking for, what we think the benefits are, maybe show a study of if we built out a conventional, how much impervious surface could be built as opposed to what we're doing, and try to lay out and talk to conservation, try to show some sort of public benefit, maybe with a trail, and then it still might not go anywhere, but I think maybe that's the process we were thinking of leaning towards going that route.
Mm-hmm. I guess I don't like the idea of just going through a process where our process is just to grant waivers to get what's needed like that. But if it's a way that we can help shape something and get us to, okay, this is what, this is how the process should form up in the future. You know, this is what a PRD or whatever we're gonna call it in the future, this is what it should achieve and what it should look like. And for this one, because we're not there yet, we'll do this through this waiver process. But in the future, we'll, you know, we'll use a different process.
I mean, I'm wondering, and this is probably off on a wild tangent, if there is the need for a an overlay district in this vicinity to resolve some of the issues, instead of doing it lot by lot piecemeal. Because I you know, if this works, however we get there, there's probably 6 or 7 or 8 other people owning similar properties. They're going to have the same problem and want to do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Which, you know, piecemeal approach to that is not really in the town's best interest, I think. But I'm not sure that I know how otherwise to approach it.
Again, I need to see this in a bigger context because I guess I don't know what the goal of these new rules would be. Is it just to make it easier to do a PRD? So what is essentially a PRD without the cul-de-sac bulb?
I think that is one way you could look at it. Or you could look at it as, you know, a less land consumptive form of development versus a standard subdivision.
But is this one even economically feasible, the traditional one? Because the size of the homes is going to be much smaller. So, you know, you've got the land and you can make the numbers work, upland, and you can show the circle, the radius, and you can get the bulb in. But then you can't really make a big enough house to justify going through with the development. Because no one's giving you cottages for this. You want to look at some sort of cottage development, you know, a starter home type development. Maybe that's a goal. But are we just looking to build out the rest of the conservation space? What's the goal?
Yeah, to a certain extent, that's why I was thinking overlay district, because it's, it's not just this lot. You know, when you look at the locus, there's a lot of issues up there.
It's worth looking at, as John mentioned, especially if it helps define some process for us.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I was thinking is, you know, each one of these rules are in place, the subdivision rules are in place for a particular reason. I mean, they weren't just pulled out of the air and say, oh, let's regulate this, let's regulate that. And so to the degree that we can look at how those really might play out and, you know, and then what the sum of all the parts is, if we change all those, are we just maxing out development in town just to max it out for, you know, property owners' benefit, which is not a bad thing, or do we end up with something, you know, sort of a different flavor of town? Is that something we want? Is that not something we want?
And I think, I mean, we're looking at this as, you know, just wiping everything out, but really it would be pavement width, curbing, street lighting. You know, you'd come in with a driveway, you'd still have to have drainage. You know, that would have to be met. So there'd still be a number of requirements you'd have to meet. You just wouldn't need 30-foot wide pavement, a big cul-de-sac, granite curbing, sidewalks at least on one side for two houses.
I don't think it's the list of waivers I'm concerned with. I think it's the ability to just put two houses on that little lot.
Yeah.
Sufficiently large enough lot for two houses to just start doing that. And, you know, in 5 lots, we've added 10 houses. That's quite a bit of development in what maybe doesn't need to be developed. I don't know. I mean, It's an interesting idea. You're right, it does have some footprint impact. If there were a way to, for it to be very, very specific without it being spot zoning, you know, where it can be done consistently in appropriate locations, without being called out as not having a set of rules to follow.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, we'd be doing it without any rules. So I'm trying to understand what we're going to do. I don't want anybody to say, well, you're just making this up as you go.
I mean, it could be the kind of thing where it's only allowed on sites that can fully prove they can get a two-lot subdivision, and you say, okay, rather than build that whole thing, how about do a common driveway? I don't know how many properties in town are only able to just do two lots.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if it was more than that, you wouldn't allow it.
I agree.
I mean, I'm sure there's different ways to slice and dice it so that not everybody can come in and do it. I definitely hear your point.
Are you here to comment on this development idea?
Me? No, this is Fred's the landowner.
Fred's the landowner.
Oh, okay.
I gave him a ride down to
the. No worries. Wasn't sure if they were abutters. Comments.
The abutters are pretty aware of everything.
Yep.
I've been there 45 years. They bring me over food.
Okay.
Couldn't ask for a nicer bunch of people. That's the biggest heartache.
All right, so we want to continue this somehow? Continue this discussion? Figure out what the next steps are?
Mm-hmm.
Try to see if we understand the impact of that of this beyond here? I'd like to see some of these examples in Lexington, you said, in
yeah.
North Andover or Andover?
North Andover.
You also did have on your agenda for 2017 to look at the PRD.
Well, I mean, we've got on our back burner, if you will, the PRD and also the so-called cluster development. But I mean, if you take a look at the long narrow lots, I mean, we talked before briefly about the what did we call it, the backland or the the back 40 kind of development.
Yeah.
What do you do with the otherwise inaccessible?
Well, why do you need to do anything with it?
Yeah, we can show you
well,
some models that we've looked at for those deep lots and, you know, the way other towns are dealing with it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, a shared driveway or an access right-of-way is one of the ways of doing it, but it's typically with one in front and one back, one behind, and there's public safety and other considerations to be aware of. I grew up in a house with a shared driveway. I know that it's, you know, I know how the whole thing works, but those lots were a whole lot smaller.
So what would the next step be then? Just keep looking at it?
What do you think you want to do, your client would want to do?
I'll talk with Fred to see what we want to do. We'll either end up going the PRD route or we'll come in with a preliminary subdivision and see how we're received. Knowing it's a chance.
Yeah.
But any development's a chance.
Yeah.
But I appreciate the time. We figured it would be good to get a discussion going.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yep.
Thank you very
Thanks.
Much.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little vague, that's all. I'm just trying to get my head around it.
Yeah. Okay, so you have a draft presentation for town meeting.
I just wanted to remind everyone about November 15th Board of Selectmen meeting at the Pleasant Street Center. We're going to have, that's the, I think Julie had sent a message about the developers roundtable discussion. Did you send something on that, on the new date? No?
Does anyone remember that?
No.
No.
But then I wouldn't
email I deleted? November 15th?
November 15th.
Don't think I did.
Tuesday night.
Tomorrow.
Julia sent a confirmation tomorrow.
Okay.
It's the night after the first night of town meeting.
Wait. Yeah, sorry. This thing's skipping days.
So at 7:15, the work that Jesse Wilson's doing on some research on economic development, she's going to give a presentation on that for about a half an hour. And then the town manager's got a few developers he wants to invite in. This is to piggyback off of the conversation we had over the summer with the combined hearing with the Board of Selectmen on downtown zoning. So that comment that someone made that, you know, the lots are so shallow in the downtown, and that creates some questions on redevelopment possibilities, and shouldn't we be thinking bigger than that? So
too deep or too shallow.
Yeah, just not right. So, you know, CPDC obviously has never talked about changing land uses when they're commercial abutting residential. I mean, we've always respected that. So, so this discussion, I guess, opens that up because the Board of Selectmen feels like that's, you know, something that should be at least discussed. And so that will be the second agenda item that night. And then the third, I'm going to give a presentation on the affordable housing 40Bs in the queue, where we are in affordable housing and meeting the 10% requirement. And then also update the board on where we are in the hiring process for the economic development coordinator, newly created position.
Mm-hmm.
All right. We'll follow up tomorrow.
Yep. So here's a very draft presentation that Jean and I put together for town meeting. First article is the powers. Just the renumbering. Tell me if I'm going too fast. Most of these are just one slide for each bylaw, and then we might think about adding in some images or some things that will really get people's attention and help explain the changes that you're making. But this one's very straightforward, so should I go on to the next one? Okay.
Yeah.
Site plan review. We have a little chart here that talks about the sections of it that we're changing and why.
Might not be legible.
I know,
the
I was
kind
saying
of
it's
small,
kind of
and
small.
That blue background people love to use for some reason, when it gets projected,
okay.
Yeah.
It just muddies up.
Right.
So I would just go black and white with boxes if you can. You can certainly have a dark title box up top.
Do you think an all white background ends up being too bright to look at?
If it's not bound by something, it's hard to sort of rein it in.
Okay.
Try it.
Yeah, the also the one slide per per item is not excessive. You know, larger print basically says that, you know, 4A21 exemption, and then a separate, or the next one would be the site plan thresholds.
Yep.
I mean, just the making, you know, a little bit larger, easier to capture.
Okay.
also suggest that instead of just clarify, you may want to write, you know, especially if you're going to do this in three slides.
Yeah.
Yeah, sort of. I know that you'd say it, why it's clarified, but just sort of a little more text on
the why.
The why.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Pet grooming. So do you think that these should all be bound by something?
Three different slides with three different formats so far.
Yep. Kind of keep people awake. There's more formats to come.
It's a lot of words. So are we doing handouts?
No.
Project it.
The warrant has the bold and cross out in the background.
Okay.
So we have the clean text in the actual warrant, but the background has all the bold and cross out because we know town meeting likes that.
Mm-hmm.
So this is again just to kind of incorporate into the PowerPoint.
Okay.
It is a lot of words, but like with slides that have a lot of words, if you just pause long enough, don't start talking about too many other things, like someone could like read it. I don't know. I mean, I think it's a combination of the slide and the actual verbal presentation.
As long as the verbal presentation isn't just reading the slide and you summarize it quickly, I think they'll be okay.
Mm-hmm.
I love how you guys are looking at me and saying you, like, I'm
well,
going to be
giving
this presentation.
Yeah.
Because I'm not.
If it's me or one
so,
of the other people,
yeah.
It's fine.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really up to you. Like, I think this is a template for you guys.
For you guys,
too.
Okay.
Yeah.
To tweak it however your presentation style, you know, works with it.
Okay.
Hmm. Tony DeRosa, 130 John Street. I really think I can stop saying that at some point. Is each one of these there its own article, or is this one big article for what we've seen
there
so far?
There are eight articles.
So, like, the beginning of this is Article 26.
So, and Article 26 is just pet grooming.
Yep. And then this is the bulk of it.
So you could actually make Town of Reading Community Planning Development smaller, Article 26, and just one slide for those two.
Yeah.
Okay. So the idea is these will tick along. I mean, you give your presentation, unlike some of the other zoning articles, you can give a 2-minute presentation on what it is.
Yeah, because it's minor.
And
we're voting in between each of these.
And we vote in between each one.
Is that what we're doing?
Right? I mean, that's the way it would go.
Yes.
So, yeah.
Yeah, as
yeah.
Separate articles.
So, okay. All right, next one.
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah, I think if we show them 5 slides for Article 26, it's not going to go. It's going to get stuck. They're going to want to know why there's so much complexity in the presentation versus,
yep.
say, the simplicity of the bylaw change.
Right.
They'll
yep.
think there's more to it. So simple.
Yep.
Yep.
I think
we're
that's
adding
what
this definition.
Yeah.
We're.
Yeah. Well, the.
Do you feel the same way about this one, or do you think this one should be? This one's more substantive. In a sense.
I don't have a problem with this one being one slide, but the text is
the
very small.
That's the thing. It's the
mm.
text is.
And so
yeah.
it looks like there's more to it than there might
yeah,
be.
Yeah, we can work
I can
with
play
that.
Around with
yeah.
that definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah, because people wonder what's hidden in the text they don't get a chance to read, or they can't see. Okay. Okay, so we'll move.
I mean, you could do them all. If you're gonna break them up, the other slides could be. That slide could be like this one, right? It could be bullets. So it's 4, 6, 2, 1.
Yep.
It was vague. You tell them why it's changing, and then bullet. So I can't remember what you wrote.
I guess I kind of thought this format was nice.
I like the table format.
Okay.
I'm just wondering if you do them individually and they just see bullets, right? There's a title.
Yeah. You're kind of breaking it down a little bit.
Specified to include lighting, mechanical systems, and landscape features. That's the basic change for 621.
Right. That works really well for like that one. I could see it being a little harder for the other ones though, where there's more nuance in our changes.
The ones coming up in the future?
No, these two, the 4622 and 4623. I mean, we can play around with it.
It's still just four bullets, and you have four bullets on the pet grooming one.
Okay, but okay, so you'd rather have like a slide like this that's all text?
I think what happens is it conveys that it's just fairly simple.
Yeah.
It's a straightforward.
The simpleness of the slide.
The
yeah.
simpleness of the slide conveys
okay.
that it's really not a big complex thing.
You don't need to
wrap your head around the table. What each not that it's a complex table, but you
yeah,
know,
it's simpler when you just
simpler.
Put the
just
bullets.
This, you know, this is what it is, and this is why we're doing it.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is what it is, and this is why we're doing it. This is
okay.
what it is.
You know. I hope you're right with that. Okay, should I move on from pet grooming?
Sure.
True.
So then we have 20.
Don't use any articles.
What?
Don't use the.
Yeah, no, okay. I know, I tend to do that because I'm like a grammar freak. Anyway.
And two, you write that out at first and then maybe see if you can simplify it.
Okay. All right. Good.
I'll give you a dollar for every article you don't use.
Then I'm going to add a bunch more in and then I'm going to edit them out.
You won't, because it won't be grammatically correct, and you won't be able to stand looking at
it. Special home occupation. This is a simple bullet one.
Mm-hmm. And we can have additional notes on hand. If we need to start explaining stuff,
mm-hmm.
get caught
mm-hmm.
up in the discussion.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to do the same thing here with Tony's idea about reducing the town of Reading community planning portion.
Yeah, I would do it to all
get,
of them.
Okay,
consistently.
Great.
Yeah, if you wanted to send me a copy of the PowerPoint, I can send you back a edited version.
That's nice. I don't mind editing it, though. I mean, it's a nice offer.
Well,
I mean, are you also going to do the presentations?
Mm-hmm.
Not if I can help it. But
so I think I'll edit it, and then whoever, Nick and John, or whoever does the presentations can take it and edit it
okay.
More. Maybe that would
Well, we
yeah.
need to be careful not to change the meaning too much.
Right, the intent.
Mm-hmm.
Right, okay. So then we have Article 28, Performance Standards. For accessory apartments, this is also a bullet.
Mm-hmm.
29, accessory buildings or structures, and this one I went back to the table format. So it has the same issue as the other slide.
Mm.
Right.
Well, I mean, you might be able to gang some of them, like entire section and garages on one story might have its own, and then.
You mean when I separate them out into slides?
Right.
Yeah, I mean, try separating them out into five slides.
Okay.
Six, and then see if gang, if that becomes too sparse. If we're voting in between, then they shouldn't get confused that this is multiple articles.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Whoever's in your presentation would tell them, you know, this next article has five slides or something.
Yeah, and the way it will flow is the moderator is going to call out Article 26. Mr. Thing, read the option, da da da. So we'll go through that itinerary every time.
Tony?
Mr. Chairman, on the home recreational facilities, While you added the category to provide for separate regulations, you might want to just point out that specifically you're trying to avoid the lot coverage for the pools and so forth. A little more explanation at that point might be useful.
Yeah,
no, they're not included. The only thing that lot coverage applies to is garages and structures for storage.
Well, basically,
yeah, that goes, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
That goes to my thought of adding that little bit more of why.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you added the category, that's great, but why did we add it?
Yeah.
The purpose of adding it was to address issues about, you know, the ability of residents to build standard size pools.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. That really was.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Should I move on to the next one?
Sure.
Lot shape.
Do you want to show them the formula? Big cross going through it.
Do you want me to?
No, we're at it. Have it on hand in case somebody says, what's the formula?
And it will be, it's in the warrant and in the report as well, so.
Yeah, bold and cross out will show it.
Yeah, the cross out, I forget how it's shown in that, but
okay.
Cross out.
I think it's crossed out, yeah.
All right.
I should probably say intended.
And
intends.
Then.
Intends to prevent.
It's all about the same.
Applies, makes, and tends. Am I wrong or right? Is it all the same?
Well, I mean, they're parallel, I understand, but I'm just trying to understand why I would say intends. Intends to prevent.
That's the intent. I could say the intent is, but that adds two words.
It's your loss.
Or I could just say prevents the creation.
Prevents.
How about just discourages?
Well, is it prevented?
That's it.
I could just say prevents.
Prevents.
Yes.
There you go.
Okay. Signs. I only have a couple slides for this, I think. I think the big thing with signs is just making sure that people understand why.
And that this isn't a fix in totality of the sign. With signs are coming back. This is just a first pass.
Right. First pass was to get into compliance with the Supreme Court ruling.
Yep.
And then recodify it to match our format for
yep.
the previous edits, right?
Yep.
And we made a few little.
Yeah, so I have that in here. So first I have, like, this is the background that I put on the website to educate people after
okay.
our hearing. And then I have the goal, and I give an example of, like, what it means.
Okay.
I think this is probably, like, in the way I see it, is this is the most important thing to explain to people. Like, we're regulating, we're changing it because we have to. And this is an example of a type of change that we made. So it's not like just a total free-for-all.
Right.
And then they'll see, hopefully they'll agree that it's very
hopefully
normal.
They'll appreciate what it took to actually get into compliance with this.
And unfortunately it makes it wordier and more confusing
mm-hmm.
in some ways, but anyway. And then I put a list of the other things that got changed this time. Basically, and I'm if you think of something I'm missing.
For signs?
That we changed, yeah.
No, we didn't.
These are just, like, big picture things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but if there are I think one of the goals that we had, or we came up with halfway through the process, was we said, forget it, we're not changing any regulation,
right.
We're just recreating them so that they're legal and now conforming.
Right.
Our goal was to make sure that nothing changed. No more permissiveness, no more exclusions. Everything is identical to what it was. If there are any changes, we have to be very specific about what they were and why we did them.
Right, and you gave me a list, which we went through, which I still have.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and that way you can highlight, or whomever can highlight exactly what the changes were, and these are the only substantive changes. Everything else is trying to keep the regulations as to what we have today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the middle sentence might scan better if you said section was reorganized to be more user friendly.
Yeah.
Wordsmithing.
Change. I don't think we want to say substantial changes will be considered, because we may go through the process and find out that we don't want to make substantial changes. I think that what we want to talk, what we want to know is just what Tony said, is that substantive changes.
Mm. May be considered.
May be
right,
considered.
Yeah, there's a key.
Yeah.
Those two words are
close, but very different.
But very
yeah.
different. Yeah, yeah. Yes, good point. All right. Anything else? That's the last one. Oops.
Yep.
I'll just now.
Okay.
So, to Tony's point, were there changes of substance in the signed bylaw that we need to, even if they were relatively small, that we need to highlight?
I have a list. I remember in most of the ones you pointed out, I said, well, we had to do that because it was content-based. And then there was one that we changed, which we changed back. It was like the highway sign distance, which we just changed back so that it wouldn't be different.
But I guess here's a question. Is, even though something had to be changed because it was content-based, the way that we changed it may result in some ability to put, knowingly
right.
changed it enough that people might be able to put different signs. And so I guess in that context, would it make sense? And I'm guessing that's what Tony picked up is, in that context, should we be clear that said we had to make some change? Here are some areas where we had to make some of these changes because
right.
we couldn't keep it one way or the other.
Did we reduce the size of some signs?
Mm-hmm. I'll look at the list
all right.
that Tony sent.
Mm-hmm.
I have it, yeah.
All right, do you get what I'm saying though?
Definitely.
I mean, because somewhere along the line, we couldn't have completely
right.
Someone has to be able to do something different than what they were able to do before.
In the past, we used to be dismiss people who wanted to put their phone numbers on the signs.
Right.
Can't do that anymore. So what's on the sign has changed. Basically, we can't even look at it really when I'm supposed to.
Right, and then I think there were some things that weren't as defined, like maybe, like you said, some of the sizes weren't as clear. And I'm pretty sure now, like, everything has a size.
Yeah, but temporary signs, we can do that. We can regulate size. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, you can have this assortment of temporary signs on your property, and I think we've given them some definition.
That is the biggest change with the temporary signs. sign, a sign per certain condition, and the biggest change is except 30 days before, I want to say, an election, all the limits are off for temporary signs. You want to put up 100 of them in your yard, you put up 100 of them in the yard. But we still regulate the size to 2x3 maximum.
I think that, stuff like that will be important to know.
Do you think that
because
that's important?
People will take advantage of, people will use that, right, that allowance, and that will be different than what happened in the past, right? It will be a change.
Yeah, it's perhaps the most significant change is to the definitions, because we can't categorize signs based on content. I think we need to be upfront saying that that's one of the thing. You can't say that it's a no parking sign, because
or a political sign.
Or a political sign. I mean, the biggest change is to make it conformant and enforceable.
The thing about that, though, is that while we're not calling by the same name, we are still allowed. So it's not necessarily changing what someone can do.
Right.
Well,
it's
yeah.
changing how it's referred to.
Yeah.
But in Tony's example, that is a change in what
someone can do.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So I think that's important.
So clean it up, we'll look at it and figure out who's going to do it.
All right.
And I'll have we have the template for the report. So I don't know if we'll have the same person from CPDC to give the report and then to go back up and do the presentation, however you want to do that, but we'll put that all together.
I saw the template today. I was looking at
Just
fill in the blanks.
Just fill in the blanks.
That's the template you're talking
about. What the vote
was,
and you know, all that. The public hearing was held on this date, and the vote was this. And so,
sounds good.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Good. Good job. Anything else? Any new 40Bs?
Not that I'm aware of. Thursday night. Stay tuned. It's the continued. Reading Village.
It's been since July.
Where's that? The
same place.
Where's the Thursday night thing?
Senior Center.
Okay.
Pleasant Street Center, yeah.
I heard a rumor. I didn't drive down Main Street today, and I heard a rumor that Perfecto's sign is up.
Oh,
I didn't see it.
Did anyone drive down Main Street?
I didn't even notice. I knew the lights were on inside.
I didn't even think to look.
I just heard that rumor. I didn't see it.
Ah.
So.
I just noticed the construction of the end of South Street with this.
There Sunday when I drove by.
Yeah, I think it went up today.
Oh, no recycling pickup today for some reason along South Street.
Hmm.
I don't know what they're doing.
Yeah.
I don't know what this recycling company is. The same as the trash pickup?
I believe it is.
I don't know what they're up to. It's just so inconsistent.
Hmm.
Well, I think they got stymied by the construction work at Main Street because they picked up on Heather Drive, but not on South Street from
South Street from Walnut to Curtis.
Right.
At least.
Hmm.
So I don't know how they make the loop.
Crazy.
Well, some computer somewhere says drive this drive this path.
Right. Motion.
Move to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
There we go.